Welcome to Science for the Non-Scientist. I'm Shamim Sinar. On this episode, I have the immense pleasure of speaking with Dr. Firdowsi Qadri, a prominent Bangladeshi scientist who has really done phenomenal work studying infectious diseases like cholera. Dr. Qadri completed her undergraduate and master's degrees at the University of Dhaka in Bangladesh, and then completed her PhD in biochemistry and immunology at the University of Liverpool in the UK. She now serves as a senior scientist at the International Center for Diarrheal Disease Research, Bangladesh. Dr. Qadri has dedicated her career to studying enteric diseases, including cholera and typhoid fever, using tools from the fields of immunology, microbiology, biochemistry, and vaccines. She has published over 370 scientific papers and has received numerous prestigious international science awards and has been recognized by philanthropists such as Bill Gates. Dr. Qadri is truly a giant in her field, driven by her passion to decrease death and sickness from diarrheal diseases. I am so excited to be able to speak with her today. Okay. So thank you again so very much for agreeing to speak with me. I know that it's a crazy time for all of us with the pandemic. I wanted to talk a little bit about your work with cholera. Many of us have heard about cholera and know it's very deadly. Can you tell us a little bit about what exactly is cholera, why it's so dangerous, and how it spreads?
Okay, so thank you for asking me this question, because with COVID-19, cholera seems to have stepped down. It's a disease that's not seen in the Western world mostly, and people have forgotten about it. If it weren't for some people around the world, some funding organizations, people wouldn't talk about cholera. But it's a disease that still kills a lot of people, 100,000 every year. It's still more than death. It causes a lot of morbidity among people. So millions every year suffer from cholera. It's a disease of the poor and of the poor countries and people who cannot afford to have clean water, clean latrines, education, basically. So it's a disease that if you have cholera, you ingest a lot of Vibrio cholerae, the bacteria. And if you ingest a million bacteria or more, you will have a chance of having cholera. But the cholera that we are afraid of is a cholera that brings you to the hospital with dehydration, which in several hours can just kill you. The dehydration is so strong that there's a purging is so big, amounts, volumes of fluid coming out of your body, that people who come to the hospital, to the ICD-DRB hospital with severe dehydration, can come with half their body weight loss. So, I mean, if you're 60 kgs, you can be 30 kgs. So, you know, your 3/4 of your body is water and there's a lot of fluid in your body and you can lose all of it because of the action of the cholera toxin, which causes the secretory diarrhea, which is produced by the bacteria. So it's a disease that can be prevented by vaccination, can be prevented if you have good socioeconomic conditions, education, and of course, clean water.
So then it, am I right that it spread through the water supply?
Not the water supply, from contaminated water. It can be in the supply, it can be in the ponds, it can be in your bucket. And also to some extent with contaminated food, because if you have food and water together and the water is contaminated, then the food is contaminated. So it's not just water from anywhere. So yeah, you can say it's actually a waterborne disease. It's called a waterborne disease, but it can be food and waterborne also.
And how prevalent is it worldwide? Which countries are the most affected by cholera?
Asia and Africa are the most affected. Now, all the less developed parts of these countries. And cholera seems to be more prevalent from generally in many countries, like in the Bay of Bengal, because of the water And because the Vibrio can thrive in these waters, and every year there are two peaks. In the winter, there's less cholera, and then in the summer, again, in the spring peak, it increases because the bacteria multiply, and its transmission is through human, from human to human. So one person gets cholera, infects the household. And so we've studied this in a hospital setting. If you have one cholera patient, you will have three people in the same household infected. So there's a difference between disease and infection.
I see.
So of the five people that we've tested, supposing on average, there will be three people who will have some immune response, antibodies that have increased, or who have been actually sick, another family member being sick, or who have, you have detected the bacteria in the stools, but they are not that sick. So it's highly contagious, highly contagious. And then the stool that passes from the person's home into the drainage and into the closed areas can also infect other people. So transmission can be very high.
I see. Yeah. And if somebody gets cholera, are they immune to it for life, or can they get it again?
We used to think that it was a lifelong immunity, but no. Epidemiological studies have shown that if you have very severe disease, then you are quite protected for 7 years or more, 7 to 10 years, but it's not lifelong protection, no. It was thought to be not lifelong, but no, it's not.
What is the best way of preventing cholera?
You're asking me, because I would say vaccines.
Yeah.
But that also doesn't give you lifelong protection, but it gives you protection 3 to 5 years. These are oral vaccines that have been developed, because previously there was a vaccine that was injected, mm-hmm. very, 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 very painful, gave a lot of severe reactions.
I see.
It wasn't of too much use. It was very short-term immunity. But then came the mechanism of the oral route that needs to be immunized, because it's an oral, it goes through your mouth, the Vibrios, and it activates the oral immune system, the mucosal immune system of the body. Mm-hmm. And so what happens is that you need to activate, with a vaccine also, you need to activate the oral mucosal immune system of the body. So giving an injection does not produce the same protection that you need as you get from a natural infection. So it's most important to take the vaccine orally. There's some vaccines that are taken orally, and cholera vaccine is one of them.
And what has been your work with the cholera vaccine? I know you've been very heavily involved for several years.
For many years, yeah.
Yeah. And so what?
So I've done sort of a whole circle of work. I've looked at the understanding the bacteria that causes the disease from many aspects, looking at the antigens they produce, the virus, the bacteria, what it produces, looking at the immune response it gives rise to in human beings when they get the disease, understanding the mechanism by which the bacteria causes the disease, mm-hmm. what kind of cells it infects. The bacteria does not invade the body, does not invade cells. It remains on the surface, but it produces toxins and many other virulence factors that create the pathogenesis, especially the cholera toxin, but it also results in producing mucosal cells, mucosal antibodies, and also it, in a different way, activates the systemic immune response also. So in the blood, you will get response to the, you will get antibodies that, or you will get cells that are activated by the Vibrios. So I've spent my life trying to understand this, using every kind of technique that has evolved over the time, using basic immunology, basic biochemistry, more high throughput proteomics, mm-hmm. and genomics. And so I've gone on with that. And at the same time, I've had the privilege to study study vaccines. And so then I have been able to compare what happens in natural infection when you have cholera, what happens when you take the vaccine. So we have people that we give the vaccine to and we look at the immune response. By that, we can gauge the capacity of the vaccine to gauge how good it is, how well it is replicating the real mechanism. So in Bangladesh, we have that joy of being able to do both things.
And currently, what is the efficacy of this vaccine? How effective is it in preventing cholera?
This vaccine can be from 60 to 70% efficacious. This is a oral vaccine that if you take the vaccine, there's a chance that you will not get cholera again. But it has two mechanisms. One is that if you take a vaccine, there's a direct effect of the vaccine. You get protection. But then people who in a population, in a household, in a setting, if vaccines are given to many people, you also have an indirect herd protection. So basically, if I say it very easily, if many people are not having the disease, they're not also spreading it. Mm-hmm. So other people are not getting the disease because I'm not infecting other people. There's less bacteria in the water, in the drains, in people's homes. And so it's not spreading. So then you have a direct effect, which can be 60%, an indirect herd protection that can together, even with a 50% coverage, like you get in a setting, if you even can vaccinate 50% of the population, you will get through the direct and the indirect effect, you will get over 90% of the people protected. And this has been shown in many studies, especially the one carried out in MATLAB. So not all vaccines have this direct and indirect protection, but because of the mode of transmission.
I see. And so what is the situation in terms of distributing this vaccine within Bangladesh and other countries?
Yeah, so that's also my favorite thing, because for many years, about 30, 35 years ago, the vaccine was first tested in Bangladesh. It's a Swedish vaccine. Mm-hmm. But that vaccine did show very good effects. But then it was rather expensive vaccine.
I see.
And also it was not so easy to, not feasible to use in settings, in field settings, in large areas, because you had to take the vaccine and mix it up with buffer and drink a large volume of it. And because you had to buffer your intestine, you know, your stomach, which has acid, you have to first bring the bicarbonate to which the vaccine was mixed so that the acidity in your stomach would not inactivate the most potent part of that vaccine at that time, which was the cholera toxin B subunit, which is a protein which gets inactivated by the acidity of the stomach. So that is why this was rather, it was a good vaccine, but it was more cumbersome for field setting in Asia and Africa. And so it was not used so much. But then the vaccine that was developed later on, more recently, was the one that the last study in Bangladesh showed that even without the cholera toxin B subunit, which was the component that made it very sensitive to the hydrochloric acid in the stomach. So even if you didn't have that sensitive protein unit, the killed vaccine strains that were there in the cholera vaccine was good enough to give you immunity. So then the next vaccine that was made, you may have heard of the names of Shancol and Uvicol. Those are the vaccines, actually Shancol, or before that, the Vietnamese vaccine that was not WHO pre-qualified, but was used in Vietnam for a long time and still being used from 1997. They make it in their own facilities in Vietnam, and then they just distribute it to areas that have a lot of cholera. And that is how they've controlled the cholera in their country. So that has been a model, and I believe in this model. So what happened, we then did a large feasibility study in Bangladesh, in Dhaka City. If you've been to Dhaka, have you been to Mirpur in Dhaka City?
I have.
Yeah. Yeah. So in that area, we did a big study in 240,000 people and showed it is so easy to give the vaccine to a large population, to 240,000 people. And you have to give two doses 14 days apart or even a month apart. And then we got very good protection, but we showed it to the government that yes, you can have a vaccine to control cholera. Mm-hmm. So that is how we've been working now. And after that, we've done a lot of studies all over Bangladesh, surveillance studies, to show that there is cholera everywhere, starting from Dhaka to Chittagong to Narayanganj to up to Sylhet and all the places. So we had 22 sites in which we looked for cholera, because in other studies, we knew that people had diarrhea, but we didn't know how much culture-confirmed cholera there was in the diarrheal cases. So we did that, and we produced evidence that, yes, there is a lot of cholera in the whole country. And based on that, and also other countries were becoming more and more, I think, anxious to have vaccines. Mm-hmm. And the World Health Organization actually felt that this was a disease that could be controlled by vaccination, but also using other multisectorial approach, like hand washing and education and teaching people to drink clean water. But the most important part was that this vaccine needed to be produced in large amounts, but also there was no plans at that time. So then the WHO made this wonderful plan, which is from the Global Task Force on Cholera Control in mm-hmm. the WHO. There's this roadmap for ending cholera by 2030. Mm-hmm. So that's now a roadmap. And this is specially meant for all countries that have cholera, especially Asia and Africa. And in that roadmap, Bangladesh has made its national cholera control plan, one of the first countries. And in September 2019, we had our national cholera control plan, in which the whole plan has been chalked out. We will start where, how we will do a demonstration project, then we will go all over Dhaka City, then we will vaccinate around Dhaka City, around Chittagong, and there's a roadmap for Bangladesh actually for control. But you see, to follow this roadmap from now to 2030 to eliminate cholera,
you cannot
eradicate cholera because it's there in the water and other sources, but you can eliminate cholera. So how can you do that? You can, there's a big plan for Bangladesh. First few years is a lot of vaccination and using water and hygiene, multisectorial approach by teaching people how to keep away from drinking unclean water and also practicing basic hygiene. But then afterwards, we know that in Bangladesh, the World Bank and other organizations are giving a lot of money, a lot of funding to improve the water system, the sewerage system, mm-hmm. and all that. By 2030, we hope all of this can be attained. But right now, what we feel is important is the vaccination program. So just before the pandemic, we did the first part of the National Cholera Control Plan. That was to vaccinate 6 thanas in Dhaka City, which we knew had the highest number of cholera cases. And if I can remember, it was like, you know, in Mohammadpur and then in Dhaka North and in Dhaka South, Lal Bagh, and then Hajari Bagh, all these areas that have a lot of cholera. So that is how we vaccinated 1.2 million people just before the pandemic struck. We were going to give them the second dose in April, but we couldn't do it because everything stopped then.
You know, that's what I was going to ask you. How has the pandemic affected?
A lot.
Yeah.
A lot. So like, you know, we were going to give the second dose in April, but the demonstration project that we carried out in 6 thanas was such a success. We did not have to go house to house to tell people to come. People came to the fixed sites, to all the sites, and they wanted the vaccine. And it was not people from the slum only. It was people coming from in Dhanmandi, people coming from their homes in Mohammadpur, coming down from their multi-storied buildings and saying, I want a vaccine. I have the same risk factors as my neighbors, so I need the vaccine too. But that showed that there was so much acceptance for vaccine. But the vaccine that we used was from the Global Task Force of Cholera Control, for cholera control, from their stockpile. Mm-hmm. Now there's a whole stockpile of cholera vaccine, but the stockpile has limited vaccine. I think in 5 years, they have, from 2013 onwards, this stockpile of vaccines has been distributed to countries that want it, either in epidemics or as or in for endemic cholera like Bangladesh. And in Bangladesh, we could see from that demonstration project the eagerness of people to take the vaccine, to understand about it. Mm-hmm. So we had to actually turn down people. We had 1.2 million doses, and we had to turn down people, and we were going to vaccinate again in April. And we told GTFCC, the Global Task Force, that this time you must give us some more vaccine. We don't want to turn down people. So these are all the good things that happened. But then 6 months elapsed, and in October we sat down, and GTFCC wanted to know, how are you going to do? What are your plans? Yeah. But 6 months had elapsed before we could breed again. And then the government and everyone and all the organizations that planned again that we are usually vaccinated within a month, the second dose. But mm-hmm. it was 6 months. And now Bangladesh had also a lot of work to do to bring its EPI program up to full strength, because of the pandemic, a lot of vaccination had slowed down.
What is the EPI program?
Expanded program for immunization in our country, basically for young children, infants, mothers, young children up to 5 years of age. So we have 11 antigens in the EPI program. We have OPV, IPV, polio vaccines, measles, rubella, HIP vaccine, hepatitis B vaccine. So there's a whole spectrum of vaccines, pneumococcal vaccine in that spectrum, that are given to all children. So that's why children in Bangladesh are so healthy now. They don't suffer so much from diseases. But within that program, there was a big measles rubella campaign coming up in March. Mm-hmm. That didn't happen. So that is going to happen now, end of November. And for that reason, there's no space to give the second vaccine now for cholera. So we will not give the cholera vaccine now. But again, in January, we are going to ask the WHO for vaccine so that we can start the demonstration project again. So this is the plan now. I hope the winter peak is not going to be too much for the COVID-19, and that we can go about activities. And although it will never be normal again, we have to have different precautions for the new vaccines for cholera. And we're also planning COVID-19 vaccines. So we don't know what is going to happen. Yeah.
I think that's the situation in many countries. Everybody is.
The situation in many countries, yeah.
That is
the support you get, that everybody's facing the same problem.
Right. Well, thank you so very much. I don't want to take more of your time, but it's been really illuminating to understand what the situation there is. Very exciting that perhaps we are on the path to eliminating cholera, or at least significantly decreasing the death and the sickness that's caused by cholera. It's very exciting. Thank you for joining me for Science for the Non-Scientist. I hope you enjoyed this conversation with Dr. Firdowsi Qadri. New episodes on Friday. Please subscribe for more science videos and conversations with scientists.